Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Johnson. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Monday, the 27th of December. Night curfews, COVID-19 curbs reimposed in several Indian states to counter Omicron. Pakistani minister takes a dig at former PM Nawaz, offers to pay ticket if he returns from London. And dozen still missing after massive ferry blaze kills 40 in Bangladesh. And now for all the details. India's central government on Monday extended the enforcement of nationwide COVID-19 containment measures until January 31, 2022, as concerns rose over the emergence of increased detection of the Omicron variant. The situation has prompted authorities in several states and capital New Delhi to reimpose night curfew. The South Asian nation as of Monday reported 578 cases of Omicron.
India's Interior Ministry on Monday issued a fresh advisory extending the enforcement of nationwide COVID-19 containment measures until January 31, 2022, as concerns rose over the emergence of increased detection of the Omicron variant. In the wake of the surge in cases, around seven states, including Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra and Karnataka, have reintroduced night curfew to counter the virus spread. Night curfew was also imposed in New Delhi from December 27 from 11 p.m. to 5 a.m. The Indian capital currently accounts for the highest number of Omicron cases at 142 out of the 578 detected as of Monday. Western Goa and northeastern Manipur state also reported their first cases of Omicron on Monday.
मैं यही कहूंगा कि population density को हम जितना कम से कम कर सकें उतना कम से कम करना है और night curfew उसका एक approved तरीका है और दिल्ली में भी लग रहा है और states में भी लग रहा है उससे हम कुछ achieve कर रहे हैं.
Meanwhile, India has accelerated its vaccination campaign amid the Omicron situation. Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced this past weekend that those aged 15 to 18 would start receiving COVID-19 vaccinations from January 3, while healthcare and frontline workers and those above 60 with comorbidities would be offered booster shots from January 10. So far, the country's 89% of the 944 million adult population has received the first dose and 61% has been fully vaccinated.
A fresh round of snowfall and rains in parts of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir affected life in the Union Territory on Monday as temperatures dropped significantly. Meanwhile, in other parts of North India, dense fog reduced visibility and residents resorted to wearing multiple layers of clothing to protect themselves from the cold.
A fresh bout of snowfall and rains in Toda town of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory made life difficult for people on Monday. Kashmir is currently going through its 40-day period of harshest winter known as Chilai Kalan, during which temperatures dip to sub-zero levels and a blanket of thick snow covers the region. Residents wore multiple layers of clothing and sat around bonfires to keep themselves warm and protect themselves from the cold.
सर्दी तो बहुत ज़्यादा है और सर्दी का मौसम है. बर्फ काफ़ी पड़ी इस वक्त पहाड़ों पे. मौसम अभी दिन ब दिन खराब होता जाएगा जैसा कि पता भी है सर्दी का मौसम है.
Meanwhile, night shelters in New Delhi provided beds and blankets to the homeless and needy people amid the chilly weather after light rains on Sunday evening significantly dropped temperatures in the national capital.
यहाँ 15 बेड हैं और फैसिलिटीज ये हैं कि गद्दे मतलब हर बेड पे गद्दे हैं, साफ सुथरी धुली हुई कंबल है, बेडशीट है, उसके बाद गर्म पानी की व्यवस्था है, साथ में फर्स्ट एड की भी व्यवस्था है.
In other parts of North India, including Prayagraj and Amritsar, dense fog reduced visibility and caused inconvenience to the people who came out for work early in the day. South Asia's winters are not as cold as other regions such as North America, but the millions of poor here are hit harder because they live in the open and do not have enough warm clothes.
In news from Pakistan. Taking a dig at Pakistan's former Premier Nawaz Sharif, Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed has offered to fund Sharif's airfare if he ever wanted to come back to the country. Nawaz Sharif was serving his term in a corruption case when he was granted an 8-week bail in 2019 to avail treatment in London due to his deteriorating health condition. He, however, has not returned despite the lapse of his bail in February 2020.
Pakistan's Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed on Sunday took a dig at former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif by offering to buy an air ticket from London if he wants to return back to the country. The remarks came amidst rumours and statements that Sharif may stage a comeback sooner than expected. 71-year-old Nawaz Sharif, the supremo of opposition Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Party, was serving his term in the Avonfield corruption case when he was granted an 8-week bail in 2019 to avail treatment in London due to his deteriorating health condition. He, however, has been living in London since then.
Nawaz Sharif saab ne aana hai, to janab main apni jeb se unko ticket offer karta hu aaj Karachi aaye. और एक वन साइडेड टिकट भी अलाउ भी करता हूँ. इतना सारा ड्रामा करके आप बीमारी का गए हैं, अल्लाह आपको सेहत दे. और यकीनन सेहतमंद हैं क्योंकि किसी डॉक्टर को तो आपने दिखाया ही नहीं.
मरियम नवाज, द डॉटर ऑफ द फॉर्मर प्राइम मिनिस्टर, आल्सो सेड लास्ट वीक दैट नवाज शरीफ मे कम बैक सून. शी हाउएवर रिफ्यूज्ड टू शेयर एनी टाइमलाइन फॉर इट. हिज पार्टी हैज मेंटेन दैट शरीफ वुड बी बैक व्हेन अलाउड बाय द डॉक्टर्स.
मूविंग ऑन, political corruption in Pakistan-administered Kashmir has hampered the illegally occupied region from attaining significant development and has led to social elements like unemployment and poverty. Local residents here have time and again raised their voices against such injustices. Recently, ad hoc employees held protest against the government demanding job regularization.
Pakistan-administered Kashmir is going through a systematic collapse of state institutions because of bad governance and corruption. Despite political transition in the illegally occupied region, as Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan's PTI, Pakistan's Tehreek-e-Insaf, emerged the single largest party in recent assembly elections, locals say they continue to suffer government's apathy. Recently, the ad hoc employees held a protest demanding job regularization. They threatened to escalate the case if the employees who were torn from their permanent government posts were not re-regularized. They demanded merit-based regularization of jobs and not through political connection or sycophancy that has been prevailing in this region.
Yahan rules ko relax karke hoti hai aur yahan ad hoc appointment sirf do buniyadon pe hoti hai, rishwat ya sifarish. Iske alawa aur koi mayar nahi hai. Ek post vacant hoti hai, uske ke liye eligible 5000 umidwar hain, unme se kiski appointment ho jati hai, baki 5000 logon ka koi zikr nahi hai. किसी एक मिनिस्टर को कोई रिश्वत देता है या उसकी सिफारिश पे एक आदमी जो है वो
This happened after the new PTI government brought down the law passed by the previous ad hoc employee regularization exemption through an ordinance, and now ad hoc employees are claiming their rights. Almost all previous governments in the region have made commitments in their election manifestos regarding development, employment and many more, but none has ever taken any concrete steps to implement the system.
Afghanistan's acting higher education minister Abdul Baki Haqqani has said co-education is against Islamic values. He also added that his government does not oppose women's education but rather the concept of men and women studying together. The Taliban have time and again said they have changed and high school for girls in some provinces have been allowed to open. But many women and rights advocates remain skeptical. Acting Afghan Higher Education Minister Abdul Baki Haqqani during a press conference in capital Kabul on Sunday said co-education is against Islamic values. His government does not oppose women's education, but rather the concept of men and women studying together, he clarified. Though Haqqani mentioned we are working on building an Islamic environment where women could study, he did not specify when girls might return to school and university classes across the country. The Taliban say they have changed and high schools for girls in some provinces have been allowed to open. But many women and rights advocates remain skeptical. Meanwhile, the Ministry for the Promotion of Virtue and Prevention of Vice has also issued a guidelines that women seeking to travel long distances should not be offered road transport unless they are accompanied by a close male relative. The Taliban have faced heavy criticism for keeping women and girls out of employment and education and excluding broad sections of Afghan society from the government. Last month, the Taliban administration released a set of restrictions on Afghan media, including banning television dramas that included female actors and ordering women news presenters to wear Islamic hijab or headscarf. However, acting Afghan Foreign Minister Amir Khan Muttaqi said the government had restored peace and security and done much to address demands for more inclusiveness with respect for human rights, including the rights of women. The country, which is also suffering from a banking liquidity crisis as the cash flow dries up due to sanctions, is facing the risk of economic collapse since the Taliban took over in August. Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Authorities buried 23 unclaimed bodies on Saturday after a day-long search failed to recover more victims or survivors of a massive fire on a crowded river ferry that killed dozens. While rescue workers were still searching for missing people, the death toll in the deadly fire that swept through a launch on the Sugandha River on Friday has risen to 40.
Victims of a deadly ferry fire were buried on Saturday at a makeshift cemetery in Bangladesh's southern Barguna district. At least 40 people died after a deadly fire swept through a launch around 3 a.m. local time on the Sugandha River in Bangladesh on Friday. Officials buried 25 unidentified victims in the makeshift cemetery after DNA samples were collected in a hope to identify them. The remaining victims were claimed by relatives. The fire started from the engine room of the launch, which was heading to Barguna from the capital Dhaka via Jhalakathi. The death toll could climb further as more than 50 people have been admitted to hospital, with some passengers still missing and some others in critical condition, said Zohor Ali, Jhalakathi district administrator. Meanwhile, as rescue workers continue to search for dozens of people who are missing, the owner of MV Abhijan 10th has been arrested. Bangladesh's elite police unit, the Rapid Action Battalion, said that Ham Jalal Sheikh was arrested from Dhaka on Monday. Reports suggest that poor safety standards and broken firefighting equipment led to higher casualties in the blaze. Bangladesh Shipping Directorate has filed a case with the Marine Court against 8 people, including 4 owners and captains of the ferry. They are accused of flouting the safety regulations and could face a 5-year prison term if found guilty.
With an aim to raise awareness against drug abuse and promote a drug-free Kashmir, around 400 people from across the country participated in the third edition of the Sky Running Championship held in Srinagar city of India's Jammu and Kashmir over the weekend. Participants from across India participated in the third edition of the Sky Running Championship held in Jammu and Kashmir, Srinagar city on Sunday to raise awareness against drug abuse. Around 400 participants ran for the Drugs-Free Kashmir that included both adults and juniors category held at the foothills of Dhara Harwan in the outskirts of Srinagar city. Sky running is an event where participants run uphill for a minimum distance of 2 km and a minimum average incline of 6% of the total distance and at least 5% of the total stretch inclines 30% or more.
ये बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है क्योंकि ये ड्रग जो है वो आजकल बहुत ज़्यादा कॉमन है इस सब को इस सब से बाहर लाने के लिए ये इवेंट्स बहुत ज़्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है इससे हमारा जो माइंड सेटअप है वो काफ़ी चेंज हो जाता है बॉडी में चेंज आती है एंड आई गेस इट्स वेरी गुड.
According to a recent study in 2021 by the psychiatric hospital in Srinagar, about 600,000 youth of Jammu and Kashmir are involved in drug-related issues that accounts for about 5% population of the Union Territory. According to the study, 90% of the drugs abusers belong to the age group of 17 to 33 years. Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline and follow us on Twitter at asianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.